and you, and you, and you, and you were there. Some of it wasn't very nice, but most of it was beautiful.
Hello, hello.
Howdy. How are you, Bryan?
I'm doing great. You?
I'm doing all right. Welcome back to another installment of Dream Idiots. And Bryan and I are your Dream Idiot hosts.
Thanks for listening. We actually, I hadn't drilled into our stats recently. We have downloads in Austria and Zimbabwe and Australia and the United Kingdom. And like, I think 30 US states so far.
Ooh,
so thanks for listening and doing those things, listening, subscribing and sharing and liking and doing all those things for us. Something like 0.1% of our listeners actually rate or put a comment on. So if we could boost that up, that'd be great. If you don't mind, on whatever platform you're listening to us on.
Yeah, that would be awesome. I've heard from some folks. You've heard some from folks. It's been a while since we've recorded because we recorded a few episodes in a row last time. So we are entering this time of the year where it's still hotter than Satan's crotch around most parts of certainly where you are. And
but it's a dry heat. Wait.
Yeah. Yeah. We had a nice thunderstorm roll past here last night. So it's a little cooler today. I think I'm going first this week. Is that right, Bryan?
You're up. Hit me with your best shot.
Okay. Strange you should mention that because this is about that song. No, it's not.
big this, Benatar fan, right? Okay.
Yeah. It is about a musician. However, I'm calling this the strange case of Washington Phillips and the beautiful mystery he bequeathed to the world. So let's talk about Washington Phillips. Have you heard about this name before I brought him up?
I've never heard this name. I have no idea who this is.
So this has been a big mystery the last really 20 years, I guess, maybe a little bit longer than that. And he's considered a gospel artist, but you might find his albums in blues sections. But he was born somewhere near Fairfield in Freestone County, Texas, which is about 88 miles south of Dallas, 152 miles north of Houston, January 11th, 1880. And he died September 20th, 1954 in Teague, Texas, where he's buried, which is out in the, I believe, the upper kind of northeast part of the state. Now, there are some sources that say he actually died in Austin in 1938 or 1939, but those have been disregarded because he had a namesake in the family, who had almost his exact name, who was a second or third cousin. So that was not him. Our Washington Phillips lived until 1954. And he was a preacher, an itinerant preacher who would travel from community to community, and he would sing gospel tunes. And only 16 tracks survive of his music.
Wow.
Which is less than Robert Johnson's, what was left of Robert Johnson. All 16 of them were recorded over 3 years' time, every time it was in the month of December, from 1927 to 1929. And Columbia Records put this together in this kind of improvised studio under the direction of Frank B. Walker. He was the producer. I found out about his music for the first time through a great book called Songs in the Key of Z, The Curious Universe of Outsider Music. It's by a guy named Erwin Chusid, who did a radio show up at, WFMU, up in the New Jersey area. And this is a great book that gives you insights into kind of these mysterious musicians that no one really knows much about, folks who've showed up, like John Deck has a big thing in there, and some other lesser known record, the legendary Stardust Cowboy, other folks like that. It's a great book. And when I first heard his music, it's not unlike hearing, and I think this is probably the best way to put it, his music is not unlike the first time that I heard Robert Johnson's original recordings, or for that matter, Daniel Johnston, the Texas outsider for the first time.
Hello, how are you?
Hello. Yeah, that's right. hi, how are you? Yeah, Daniel. I ran into him once at a comic book store in Houston. And
Johnston?
Yeah, he's a big comic book guy. And so I ran into him at Third Planet in Houston one time. And part of me, I was like, don't bother him. No, bother him. Tell him how much you like his music and find out what comics he's buying and that kind of stuff. I didn't talk to him. I left him alone. And after he passed, I was like, maybe I should have said something.
But, oops.
Really eerie stuff. I had a guy who lived down the hallway from me, my freshman year in college from Arizona, named Carl. And Carl was a big Rolling Stones fan. And he introduced me to Robert Johnson's music. And he said, do you ever listen to Robert Johnson late at night on your headphones and get scared? I'm like, yeah, kind of. I can see that's the kind of music that does that. He has been covered. Washington Phillips, our man Washington Phillips, has been covered by Sister Rosetta Tharpe, Will Oldham and the Palace Brothers, the Animal Collective, Mogwai, Jillian Welch, Rykooter, and Fish are among the artists who've covered his music at one time or another. Now, I said he had a mystery because no one's really sure for the longest time. I think they figured it out now, but no one was really sure what he played to accompany himself, because it's just vocals and accompanying himself on some kind of stringed instrument. Some folks said it was something called a dociola, which is a zither-like, has a zither-like body. It's got 60 wires with a miniature keyboard on one end. It was a tabletop instrument, so you could play the keys and strum if you needed to as well.
Right.
So
like a dulcimer.
So you could do the chordal structure, say, by holding the strings down and then have a some kind of melody on the keyboard side of things. There was an ad reproduced in the complete recorded works of Washington Phillips from Yazoo Records, which for many years was the only disc out there of his music. I mean, it's the same 16 tracks over and over again. But it has an advertisement for what they call a miniature grand piano. Now I'm quoting directly from this advertisement. The dociola is the only musical instrument ever invented that has been demanded and sold in every country upon the globe the first year it was on the market. It is endorsed by leading musicians everywhere, as well as the nobility of Europe. The dociola, with its four full octaves, embodies the exquisite tone of two guitars and two mandolins. Its action, while similar to that of a piano, is quicker and more simple, permitting effects impossible with a larger instrument. Any class of music can be played. Music lovers are delighted with it. You must own one. And then there's testimony from some folks. Arthur, they don't say whether he's an author of, but author Charles K. Harris, the Princess of Eisenberg, Darmstadt, Germany, and then someone simply referred to as a musical authority of New York, have all called this the new instrument. Now, one of the mysteries is that the way the music sounds, there's no one really knew what it was he was doing. Some folks said that he would assemble who he played for, said that he assembled it there on the spot and it looked like it was made out of different parts. Let's just take a listen to the music here. Brian, you've got it queued up for us. This is a song called Take Your Burden to the Lord and Leave It There. Let's listen to a few few seconds of this and see what we think.
Leave it now, oh, leave it now. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. If you will trust him and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. I have the word from you withhold of its silver and its gold, and you'll have to get along with major staff. Just remember in God's word how he fed those little boys. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. I hope your body suffers pain, and your health you can't.
That's good. There we go. So what do you think?
That's super cool. It sounds a lot in my mind like a harpsichord.
Yeah, some people have thought it was a harpsichord.
Right.
It's got that kind of, I don't know how to describe the sound because I'm not a musician.
Yeah, me neither.
It's this harp-like kind of, well, let's get back to my text here. What folks think today is that he was playing something called a mandzarine, which some folks have said is basically two zithers that were perhaps attached together to allow chordal and melodic structures to a song. So you play the chords on one side and you play the melody on the other. So it's a double-sided zither, if you will. There's a guy named Greg Miner and someone named Kelly Williams who have an exhaustive history of this evolution of thinking by musicologists as to what exactly Phillips was playing. Miner and Williams relied on the experiments and contributions of the late Gary Harrison. He collected fretless zithers and he was a traditional music performer. And it was Harrison's work that led to this dual zither theory. Now, in 2018, the music you heard, it's one of 16 cuts that's available out there. And like I said, it's been repackaged several times. But in 2018, an album entitled Washington Phillips and His Mandzarine Dreams was nominated for two Grammys, Best Historical Album and Best Album Notes, because they went through the entire history of
right, sure.
You know, what they thought was going on with his music. And of course, immediately a group of his fans, because he was nominated, immediately called him a sellout, and they said he liked his early stuff better. that didn't happen. But regardless of what instrument was that he played, he left us two things. One, I love a mystery, and I love the fact that there are still things that we haven't figured out in the world and in the universe. This has been one of those little mysteries that I've kind of thought about since I just discovered that album way back in, when did I get that? Sometime in the early 2000s, I picked up this Washington Phillips. I think I bought it when I was still living in New York. He left this incredible collection of 16 tracks, just, you know, very small body of work that has been described by, and I'm quoting from a variety of music critics, haunting, otherworldly, eerie, ethereal, and Elysian. I call it timeless. I call it absolutely timeless. It sounds like it's coming from another planet, another time and another place. And I can't say there's been anything else like it that I've really heard that has dropped my jaw the first time I heard it in terms of traditional American music. It's one that just kind of leaves me. I listened to this collection several times while writing this story, so it was always on in the background. And I'm not the biggest fan of gospel music. I have a few gospel albums in my collection, but it's really remarkable stuff, I think. What are your impressions of it?
No, it's definitely very, you know, very cool. The sort of the origins of Americana and gospel and roots music. I mean, my knowledge of it is by no means encyclopedic. I do like a lot of the, you know, the music that obviously came later, 50s and 60s and so on. But it is definitely you know, very ethereal. It's very, very cool though. But again, you're right though. I can't think of when you talk about, you know, Etta James or some vocalists that are not, obviously not as old as he is, but, you know, not too far after. I mean, there's nothing really that comes to mind that I would say sounds similar.
No,
I'm not really sure why.
You know, because when you get to like one of my favorites, Sister Rosetta Tharpe, you know, she was one of the first rock and rollers.
Right.
And Bob Dylan always said, she's my favorite guitarist because she was a heck of a guitarist. And she had similar themes from a gospel nature, but in a secular world. Things like strange things are happening every day. I hear music in the air. But yeah, nothing else to me sounds quite like this. The album that I used, and album notes that I used for some of this work, was by Pat Conti. He wrote the album notes for Washington Phillips. And the collection I have is called I Am Born to Preach the Gospel from Yazoo Records in 1991. CNN.com had a nice piece called Washington Phillips Gospel's Great Disappearing Act, written by Daniel Burke in December of 2016. Spectrumculture.com had an article called Washington Phillips and His Manzarine Dreams, written by John Paul in December 1st, 2016. Your radio station, Bryan, KUT.org.
Nice.
Washington Phillips and His Manzarine Dreams, A Mysterious Texas Gospel Artist Resurfaces by Trevor Young in January of 2018. KUT.org is the public radio station broadcasting out of University of Texas, correct?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, we used to trade programming with them back when we had to ship reel-to-reels back and forth in the 80s and 90s.
back you know, shortly after the Punic Wars, when things were still on reel-to-reel.
No, I remember from KUT, because KUT, we used to get, we'd either send it to them or get from them music from the Hearts of Space.
Hearts of Space, yeah.
Yeah, we would get that one. Minormusic.com, this is the Greg Minor and Kelly Williams work I was telling you about, has a great article called The Instruments of Washington Phillips, written originally or published originally in May 2003, but with updates in September of 2015. Erwin Chusid's 2000 book, Songs in the Key of Z, The Curious Universe of Outsider Music, Acapella Press, and Wikipedia for basic article on basically Freestone County in that part of Texas, because I'd never heard of Freestone County. I mean, Texas has so many counties, but for basic information on Phillips and Freestone County, and Fairfield, Texas.
Nice.
So there you go. Just a little clip of history there. And you know, I'm kind of reminded it just occasionally Texas crops up, because some really important stuff was recorded in Texas. Robert Johnson's, a lot of his stuff was recorded at the Blue Bottom Hotel in San Antonio.
Yeah, I knew that.
Yeah. And then, and the rest were in Dallas, and same here, his material was all recorded in Dallas. So anyway, there you go. The mysterious Mr. Phillips and the beautiful mystery he left the world.
Excellent. Thank you. That was killer.
Yeah, it's good stuff. All right.
All right, we're going to shift gears here a little bit.
It's time for the Dream Idiot's Curse Word of the Week.
So this one comes from, ever heard of Susie Dent before?
Susie Dent.
From Twitter, Susie Dent is a, she's a English. She's done a couple different BBC television shows, but she's mostly known as a writer and lexicographer. And she just posts random words on Twitter and things that she thinks are funny or interesting. So curse word, not really a curse word, but the word is mubble fubbles, mubble-fubbles. Mubble fubbles comes from the 16th century. Any idea?
A state of clumsiness where you're dropping stuff and messing up. And close. Okay.
No. Well, that would, excellent guess. I mean, the word kind of set me on that makes sense in terms of just how the word sounds, but it is, the vague Sunday evening-ish blues and a slight sense of doom. So it's sort of like, so, you know, having a case of the Mondays, the mobile fubbles.
Okay. So it's like 4 o'clock Sunday afternoon, football's over. And it's time to realize you got it.
Yeah. Yeah. You have to pull your shit together because Monday's coming, basically.
There's a famous song called Gloomy Sunday, which is kind of about that you've probably heard about that.
Gloomy,
they say it caused suicides.
Is it the Monkees or who's that?
No, not that song. No, that's Pleasant Valley Sunday. No, this is an old song from way back when, from like the 20s or 30s. I can't remember but it kind of dealt with this idea of a gloomy Sunday.
Right.
And it reportedly led to the suicides of several people who performed it and so forth.
Okay.
But mubble fubbles also sounds like something that Pooh Bear would say to Owl or Piglet, doesn't it? It's heffalumps.
When he's frustrated, right?
Yeah. Oh, mubble fubbles. It's heffalumps.
It's the sound of a fart in the bath, right? A mubble fubble.
We've gone from the sublime to the ridiculous this time. That's so 16th century.
Yeah.
It just, they had that even back then, I guess, huh?
I guess.
I mean, their football was probably over by 4 o'clock too. So.
Well, that was back when, you know, everyone was working 7 days. There wasn't any fucking weekend. So I don't know. But anyway. Mobile fumbles.
Maybe it's the depression of having had to stay in church longer than you wanted when you could be out doing stuff outside. Or it's interesting. The mobile fumbles. That's a new one for me.
All right. Planting seeds. That's all we do. Okay. All right. So for my little segment this week, we're going to go into the world of psychopaths.
Oh boy.
Fun.
But we're not a true crime podcast.
Yeah, disclosure, we are not a true crime podcast, right? We're not actually going to be talking directly about crime or, you know, any particular criminal event. It's, you know, exactly. But a few years ago, just randomly, because I was doing research into other things and doing some reading, it was one of those situations where you keep hearing a word and then you go, I keep hearing this word. What does it actually mean? And so I was doing some digging into the terms malignant narcissism and what is a psychopath versus what is a sociopath? Because in podcasts, in true crime podcasts, I mean, the word psychopath or just the word crazy is used all the time. And I was like, what does that really, really even mean? When our previous president was in office, he was often referred to as a psychopath, probably accurately so. And if you've watched the news at all, conspiracy theorist and well-known piece of shit Alex Jones, something tells me he probably counts as a psychopath because he just seems so off the deep end in so many ways. But I came across a gentleman by the name of James Fallon. Fallon is, this is not Jimmy Fallon. This is not the story of The Tonight Show. James Fallon is.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I think James Fallon now is probably about 70. And in 2005, he was working, and I believe still works, at the University of California at Irvine. So he's a professor and neuroscientist. And at the time, 16, 17 years ago, he was doing research into basically the nature of psychopaths and psychopathic killers. So he was trying to find commonalities across them to see what causes them and what traits they all seem to share. And so he had access to a sort of a treasure trove, I guess if you can use that word, of fMRIs of, in one article it says dozens, in another article it said hundreds of individuals who were criminals who were deemed to be psychopaths. And so he had all these images of these brains. At the same time, he was doing another project that was essentially kind of unrelated, a side project at the same time into Alzheimer's research, Alzheimer's disease. And so he, you know, by virtue of this study, he had also pulled together a bunch more MRIs. And because he's a scientist, and because you know this probably from your academic background, you have to be careful. You have to have, you know, a good control group, and has to be a double blind study, and you have to make a conscious effort to make sure that your data collection is good, etc. So he has this, you know, collection of scans of, you know, crazy people's brains. They were killers. And then he has this collection of students and randoms. He's had himself scanned. He's had his entire family scanned just to, you know, pad out this control group. And so as he's diving into, you know, looking at these images, he realizes that in one of the images in the control group, there's one person in the control group that is very obviously, it has that psychopathic image pattern. There is this diminished activity in the, I think it's the orbital and temporal lobes, that is predictive of psychopaths. So he goes to the technician who is doing the scans and says, yeah, the machine's screwed up. We have someone in our control group is psychopath, and that can't be true. So check the machine. They check the machine. The machine's fine. So now Fallon has to figure out what he should do. What's the proper course of action? And so he's kind of weighing his options about whether to sort of break the seal and figure out who this person is, so he can, you know, basically extract their data from the study. After pondering for a while, he decides, you know, he basically has no choice. And so he looks up, you know, there's probably some sort of whatever participant number that he can pull, and then, you know, dive into the database to figure out who this person is. And guess who it is?
It's him.
It's him. Yes. So he breaks open the seal and sees his own damn name. Weirdly, at that point, he sees this and he kind of ignores it. He kind of blows it off. And for a year and a half, apparently didn't tell anyone, didn't really think about it, just kind of set this piece of information aside and pretended it didn't happen, I guess.
Like a psychopath would.
Exactly, right. So subsequent to this, another colleague of his who was, you know, was wanting him to do some research on bipolar disorder. And this individual was, they were doing some work together, invited him to come do a presentation, in Oslo. This scientist was from Norway, and they did a bunch of research into genes and genetic trends and how these genetic markers can be predictive for all kinds of things, you know, bipolar disorder, depression, psychopathic behavior, you know, blah, 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 blah. And so, you know, a year and a half later, he goes to Oslo, and as part of his presentation to this group of scientists, none of whom he knows, he presents his own, you know, basically his own file, his own patient file. And he's now being told by people that he doesn't know, Dr. Fallon, you're a psychopath. You know that, right? You have, not only do you have the predictive factors in the imagery, but you also have the gene markers that are predictive for psychopathic behavior. There is apparently a gene that they have identified that is passed down from mothers to sons, called MAOA, that is very, very prevalent in psychopathic killers. And it really is, up until now, you know, for 18 months, he blew it off. And now it becomes much more of a kind of a front of brain problem. He's thinking, wow, okay. So I'm not really sure what I do with this information. So he flies home, and then instead of deciding to hide it, he just decides to own it and start talking to everyone about it, that, you know, talks to his family, talks to coworkers and colleagues about it. He goes to two different colleagues who work in psychology, and say, hey, look, isn't this funny or interesting? And, you know, turns out I'm a psychopath. And they say to him, yeah, we've been telling you you're a psychopath for years. This is like saying, yeah, you have a beard. Yeah, I mean, this is patently obvious. Yes, we've been calling you a psychopath to your face. And he goes, well, you've always said that I was crazy, but no, we didn't say you were crazy. We've been calling you a psychopath because it is undeniable. Brings this up then with his family, his wife, and I think he has either five or six children. And he sort of sheepishly brings it up to them as well. And they too instantly, yep, yeah, makes sense. So self-involved, narcissistic, aggressive, yep, you have all the markers for someone who's a psychopath. Like, oh shit. Wow. Okay. I had, it's becoming much more of a, not really a concern, but it's a little bit alarming that it's been, so invisible to him seemingly.
And everybody's reaction to it, because I think he had a brother too that like said, yes, I've thought about that. I thought you were like this since you were a small child, so, just the things you would do.
Yeah, yeah. So you've heard this story.
Oh, this is one of my favorite. It's absolutely fascinating. Yeah, okay. It's okay. Just an absolutely fascinating story. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Okay.
No.
So this MAOA gene, this happens. He's early mid 60s. He goes to his mother, who is still alive, and tells her as well. And then she says, oh, just a reminder that we are distantly related to Lizzie Borden.
Oh, I didn't know that part. Holy cow. Yeah. Okay.
By the way, there are seven different men who are direct, ancestral relations to the Fallon family name, seven different men who were convicted murderers over the last 250 years. Like, oh shit, this is getting more and more and more serious. And you're right, your joke about how it was, psychotic that he learned this and then decided to ignore it. His friends pointed out to him as well. It's like, okay, once you learn this, and the fact that you're able to dismiss it is definitely representative.
Yeah, I was joking, not joking when I said that. I mean, it was
that's exactly, that's spot on correct.
I mean, if that had happened to, I would like to think that if I found that out, I'd be like, oh, this is going to keep me awake for a while. This is right.
Well, this is, but distinctly alarming.
Right. Yeah. And the other thing is that everybody's reaction to it is almost like an apathetic intervention. Like, yeah, I know we've said about this with every, right. To a person, it's like, uh-huh. Yeah. We've been saying this for years.
Yeah, it's the nose on your face, you dumbass. Right. So, the fact that he has these traits, it's very, I mean, the combativeness and the competitiveness and aggressiveness. I mean, this is Donald Trump in a nutshell. The whole having to get, the petty grievances and having to get even and being seemingly stoic on the exterior. But if there's a slight, Fallon goes on and on, talking about the fact that where he can't let things go. If he feels like he's been slighted, he has to get even. And it's the case that when you have this gene trait, basically what has happened is that when you're in utero, you have been bombarded with so much serotonin that when you are an adult, serotonin is basically no longer effective. And so someone has insulted you, and for you or I, or for a normal functioning human being, serotonin kicks in and has that sort of soothing, de-stressing effect. And that slight goes away within minutes, or if it's a major slight, whatever it is, it vanishes. But if you've been set up to fail in this way genetically, it just festers and it literally never ever goes away. So this, his blind competitiveness and narcissism is just, now readily apparent, both to he and essentially everyone he's ever come in contact with says, oh yeah, exactly the case. The competitiveness, I did watch part of at some point in the past couple of years. There was that new documentary on Michael Jordan. And of course he and, you know, guys like Kobe Bryant and, you know, I'm sure there are other, a boatload of other examples I'm spacing right now on, but you know, these athletes, who are so wildly, desperately competitive that they, you know, the play a game of checkers with their five-year-old son and just kick the shit out of them because they just can't lose. And I mean, that has to be, I mean, I wonder now if is everyone like that, a psychopath, or is that just being a dickhead? I don't quite know. I never quite understand that, you know, winning is everything, not the only thing vibe, but definitely it's a very common psychopathic symptom, I guess.
Well, it certainly changes the priority of things when you don't have serotonin coming in to regulate it as, you know, as nature's Valium, so to speak.
Right.
I've always wrestled with like this whole idea of being competitive and having to win at any cost. And then they're perfectly normal off the field or off the court. That's another thing entirely, right? You're just a hard-nosed competitor. But when you get off the court, you can be a normal human being, which kind of leads me to my question for you then is, what do you think the difference is between a psychopath and a sociopath? Because I'm not sure these terms are used much anymore, but I find them useful as in terms of differentiating, oh, what am I dealing with?
Right. Well, I mean, broadly speaking, I think a psychopath, you know, somewhere in my reading, I believe it's the case that they believe somewhere between 0.5% and like 3.2% of the population are psychopaths, and sociopaths then are even a smaller set. Sociopaths, you know, it's both in that section of mental disease where people cannot deal with, you know, it's a personality disorder and they can't deal with emotional distress, but it's the sociopaths are ones that have just no compulsion control whatsoever. Psychopaths are, you know, off the deep end, but they're more measured, they're more calculating, and they're more controlled. Sociopaths are just, you know, reckless, impulsive, etc. I think is broadly speaking is the difference between the two.
Okay, that kind of dovetails with the way that it was always explained to me, was that psychopaths don't understand why they are and what they're doing. It just comes as who they are, mm-hmm. as opposed to a sociopath who knows what they're doing is wrong, but they do it anyway because it feels good.
Right.
I mean, I don't know if that makes any, that's the way it was always explained to me. And I don't know what the accurate way to describe it is. My minor in psychology from 25 years ago has been pushed so far back to the back of my brain that I can't, you know, I can't bring right. up the proper terminology, but I mean, just the fascinating aspect of being a healer, a scientist, to look at your own brain scan and go, oh, hey, I'm a psychopath, and then put it down and go,
that's interesting. Right.
Oh, right. You know, yeah, hey, I feel go. Hey, golf's on, you know, and then turn around right. and watch TV.
Right. Just completely shift gears. Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, Bugs Bunny is the sociopath. Daffy Duck is the psychopath. No.
I think
something close to that. I don't know.
We'd have to ask my grandmother what her opinion is on that one, given how much the kind of opinion she has of Bugs Bunny.
Right.
The other thing that I find interesting with this is the whole MAOA branch of it. And one of the things that, the guys over on Last Podcast on the Left, who cover a lot of folks who fit into this category. Marcus Parks has an interesting theory as to why we had so many, what we would call psychopathic serial killers in the 70s. And I think it's fascinating. Well, a lot of these guys had significant brain injuries when they were kids.
Right.
That was a big factor of it. And then, you know, he brings that up a lot. And I think there's something to that when you look at just plain old serial killers. And the other thing that Marcus brought up that I thought was really fascinating was we also, when these guys were young and in utero, we had a whole lot more lead floating around in the environment.
Oh, interesting. Because
of leaded gas. Yeah, sure. Right. And I was like,
there's lead in paint. There's, yeah, right, right.
There's lead in paint. There's lead in everything. I mean,
right.
you know, toothpaste. toothpaste, pencils. I mean, gas, which means if it's in the gas, it eventually gets into the atmosphere, even if it's right. I mean,
right.
You would think that that would probably happen. So, you know, this confluence of brain injury and this AOA stuff that you're talking about, possibly lead paint. I mean, there's a reason people call the 70s the golden age of serial killers. I mean, good Lord. I mean, you couldn't hitch a ride safely without running into it.
Right, right. Well, I mean, if, you know, Fallon gets into it as well, because, you know, it's kind of the nature versus nurture situation. But,
sure.
You know, he basically, I think he believes now that the reason that he is not an axe murderer is his mother, you know, his parents had several miscarriages before he was born. And so he was born and he was just doted upon and, you know, a very, very loving household. And so, you know, that nature or nurture rather, you know, overrode any, you know, genetic marker or anything else that would have defined him, you know, eventually sent him down a different course of action. Because you're right, you know, tons of these psychos either had some sort of brain trauma, they're in a motorcycle accident, they fell out of a tree, or they're just beaten senseless because they had a psycho for a parent. And that is, you know, there's a one-to-one correlation between trauma and that trauma then, you know, echoing itself and being present again in their behavior. So, you know, nurture is a good thing.
And to that point, be nice to strangers, because no, seriously, I mean,
I'm laughing, but I agree. Yeah.
You never know. And I mean, you might prevent something from happening to you or someone else by just a little, hey, how are you today? And a smile, or, you know, it could go the other way and you could get, I mean, I don't know. This is a fascinating case though. This guy who just suddenly realizes and then doesn't do anything about it. And then my favorite testimony, I think, is from I saw this in a mini documentary or something, but the brother's like, oh, when you were your kid, you pull these pranks that you thought were hilarious. And it was like, I'm bleeding.
Yeah.
Injured me.
It went one of the things I read that they go on to, you know, talking about the fact that he was the kid in the neighborhood where other parents were like, well, they wouldn't let their kid go around to play at his house because that kid's, there's something is off with that kid, and they couldn't quite put their finger on it. But what's funny now is what, you know, I saw, he has, I think, two different TED Talks I watched as well. And so he's talking about the fact that now that he knows he's a psychopath, he has to engage in this weird front of brain kind of game where he has to consciously think about what is the right thing to do. And so, he readily admits, I mean, to his eternal credit, he readily admits that before he realized this, he was self-involved. If there was, you know, 2 inches left in a bottle of wine, he would take the bottle of wine and fill his glass, and anyone else wanted wine and didn't get any, well, tough shit. But now when he is just interacting, just day-to-day life, routine tasks, he has to think about opening doors, you know, being considerate in this conscious way. And he was like, well, but this can't be effective because it's disingenuous to who I am. But he's talking to his family about it, and they're like, no, you're way nicer. You're way kinder now than you ever have been before. And we don't care that you have to think about it. We appreciate the fact that you're actually having to think about it, and you know how you, I mean, you know who you are now, and you're actively taking steps to correct it. The fact that it's not natural doesn't matter to us as long as you're doing it. So it's a weird, I mean, it sounds sort of exhausting to have to really think about, you know, if you see someone carrying packages coming up to a door, you have to really, it's not just rote, but I mean, just be exhausting after a while. But apparently that's his way to sort of tackle it. Well,
he's got to compensate, right? I mean, that's right, his form of compensation, to be able to navigate the world. And again, when you look at these folks, whether it's nature or nurture, I mean, I feel bad for these folks. I mean, I feel bad for them. And when you have someone who knows what they are and is struggling with it, that's even sadder, you know, just like, oh my God, I'm a horrible, what's wrong with me? And but they have to have that same thought again and again, because they're never going to imprint that into their
right. Yeah, because I mean, that's a vast preference over the person who is just in that narcissistic mode and who you can't reach and who just doesn't give a shit. Because I certainly have been there with multiple people in my life in the past where it's like, you know, you're engaging in terrible behavior and you simply don't care. And so that's certainly worse.
Right. I'm not saying you're an asshole. I'm saying that you're behaving like an asshole, right? Is the difference. Separate that behavior from the person, I guess, is right. What the lesson is. This is fascinating stuff, Bryan.
As I said on one episode weeks and weeks ago, where we the curse word of the week was asshole, and I made the joke that if you're listening to this and you're wondering, hey, wait, am I the asshole? You know, if you're asking yourself that question, you're not the asshole. Well, the same applies here. If you're listening to this thinking, geez, I wonder if I'm the psychopath here, because I guarantee you, just Google, is there a test for the psychopathic test? I guarantee you there are tests out there. The fact that you're asking yourself the question or not means that you are not a psychopath, just by definition, probably.
You're probably on the better road at that point. Yeah.
right. The fact that you're even pondering it.
And for once, we didn't have any synchronicity. We had a nice story about a missing gospel musician who vanished from history, and then we have a story about a psychopathy. So yeah, that's nice little contrast there.
So I will say James Fallon has a book called The Psychopath Inside that came out in, I believe, in 2014.
Oh, that's right.
14, yeah. Which I have not read yet, but I intend to. And then some of this came from Wikipedia and New Yorker, but mostly came from January 21st, 2014 article from Atlantic Monthly by Judith Ohukwuori. I've been bad about including my references. I'm making a point of sticking those things in there.
See, Bryan, you're learning. You're learning how to get the world, how to fit in better.
I try to do one thing right every day. It's hard.
I do one thing at a time. I do it very well, and then I move on.
All right. Well, there you are, folks. Cool. Thanks again for listening and sharing and doing all those things. We appreciate it.
Be good to each other. Thanks.